Hi, everybody, and welcome to AP Laser Workshop. Hope everyone's having a fabulous Monday here today and getting your work week started off right. I also want to welcome everybody to us doing this live YouTube for the very first time. We're hoping to start pushing out to do it this way in the future, just to make it a little bit simpler and easier for people to register and sign up for the classes and really open it up to have more people join us today. So what we're going to be doing today is we're going to be working with another one of our rotary tools, our newest and latest on the market. And we're going to be using a stainless steel Arctic tumbler. And we'll be using the Surmark spray to actually engrave on it. We'll also be working with our Lightburn program and walk you through how to just kind of set up a real quick, simple vector image there. So without further ado, let's go ahead and jump over to my laptop here and let's get started. So the first thing I'm going to do is go ahead and open up my Lightburn program. And the image that we're actually going to be working with today is this little JPEG here. And I got this JPEG from a program called Dover Publications. And basically what Dover Publications is, it's a place to get high quality clip art and things like that. It comes with a nice booklet showing you the images and also shows you a little CD-ROM that you can download all the images into your laptop so you can always save them for future use. So we're gonna go ahead and go back to Lightburn here and we're gonna import in our image. Look right here, and I figure we're getting close to Halloween, so a nice little skull image would probably be a little bit fun to do. Now, what's nice about Lightburn is it does bridge both designing aspects and an operating program into one platform. It does a great job on tracing out vector images, and it's really nice, again, just to be able to design something or trace something in this program and send it right to the machine. So now that I've got my JPEG in here, what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to right click on my mouse and come right down here to trace image. So I'm going to zoom in here a little bit so we can kind of see, and we can kind of see this kind of purplish pink line going around showing us where our trace is at. You can always come down here to this threshold and you can adjust this more or less to try to get a little bit of a tighter trace. Zoom in a little bit more. I'm not sure if you can see that, but when I bring this up, we can see those lines kind of manipulating and coming in a little bit. It does do a pretty good job of just bringing it in and tracing it without a whole lot of adjusting. So I'm going to go ahead and hit OK here. And then I'm going to move my traced image away from my original image, just like that. So again, we can see how we got almost a carbon copy here. I'm going to go ahead and select my original one and delete that. And then I'm going to select my image here. And from here is where I'm just going to start sizing it up a little bit, make sure it's going to fit on my tumbler. I did measure things out a little bit beforehand, and so I know I've got right around 3 inches, 3.5 inches to work with as far as my placement goes. So I'm going to come up here to the top left-hand corner, and the first thing that I want to do is I want to click on my lock ratio button. What that's going to allow me to do is adjust my height, and it will self-adjust my width here so I don't distort my image at all. So I'm just going to come here to my height, I'm going to hit 3, and go ahead and hit enter. The next thing that I want to do is I want to go ahead and rotate my image. So my rotate is right here. And so I'm going to rotate this a negative 90 degrees. Down a little bit more. There we go. So the lip of our tumbler is going to be on the left-hand side here. I'm then going to go ahead and I'm going to double-click where my speed and my power is. And this is what's going to allow me to adjust my speed, my power. I can tell it if I want it to do a line, which will be cut. If I wanted to do a fill, which will be an engrave, a fill and a line, so engrave and cut, and do an offset fill. So I want to make sure that I'm selected fill. I can adjust my interval here, just like in RD Works. I can either do lines per inch, so I could type in 300, or I can do a line interval of a 0.00333. Another important feature you want to make sure is that you want this to say fill all shapes at once, or fill groups together, and then we have fill shapes individually. Make sure fill all shapes at once is selected. If any of these other two are selected, what's going to happen is it's going to engrave part of the image and can jump around, and especially with working with the rotary tool, just basing on how it spins and everything, it can throw your engraving off. Having this fill all shapes at once will make sure that it just does a continuous engraving. I'm going to go ahead and hit OK here. I'm going to select my laser origin for left center. Again, this is just my personal preference here. Other customers prefer the center or the right center. Any one of these center locations is more than perfect to use. Again, I just prefer the left center. Now, I went ahead and did a little bit of prepping beforehand, so I've already engaged my rotary tool. If you're setting this up for the first time, you just want to make sure that your machine is powered on. And then you'll want to come up here to Tools, come down here to Rotary Setup. You want to make sure that you're selecting whether you're using a chuck rotary or a roller, and we're going to be using a roller. You want to enable rotary. And then you want to make sure that your steps per rotation and your roller diameter are set. We don't need to worry about object diameter or circumference. And again, I've kind of set this up ahead of time. But if not, I'm going to exit out of here, and we're going to bring up our handy-dandy little cheat sheet. And so this here is the rotary tool we're going to be using today, our brand new black extender rotary tool. I'm working with a three-phase motor, so I want my circle pulse to be 7505 and my roller diameter to be 2.62. Our rotary, and so we've got 7505 and we've got our 2.62. Now typically once you've engaged this in your Lightburn system and hit OK is when you'll want to go ahead and power off your machine and go ahead and hook up your rotary tool and flip your switch if need be. Again, I've already gone ahead and done those steps, so I'm going to go ahead and send my file over to the machine here. All right, and we'll jump over to our machine. So again, what we're using today is going to be an Arctic tumbler. It is a stainless steel tumbler. And I've already gone ahead and sprayed it with my Surmark spray. The Surmark spray that I'm using is going to be the LMM 6000. Works great for a variety of different types of metals, brass, copper, stainless steel. Before you actually go out and buy the Surmark, make sure that you are looking, because they do carry different types, some specific to certain types of metals. So you just want to make sure that you're buying the correct type. Now, before spraying the Surmark onto your product, it's always a good idea to clean the tumbler ahead of time. What I do is I use a little bit of denatured alcohol along with some paper towel, and I basically just kind of drip it on there and wipe it off. What that's going to do, that's going to get off any kind of oils or residues or anything like that that may get in the way of my engraving. So once I've done that and I've actually sprayed my Surmark on here, now this isn't like spray paint. You don't want to spray a lot of it on there. It doesn't need to be a real thick coating. A nice, even, light coating will work. You just want to make sure you don't have any empty spots in here to where it's spraying off to leave the silver still shining through. So again, a nice, even coat. Staying around 4 to 6 inches away and spraying it will help make sure that that's getting coated evenly. So after that, we're going to go ahead and jump inside my machine here. And I'm going to go ahead and load up my rotary tool. Now, with this particular tumbler here, very similar to our Yetis, is I've got a stamp right here of the Arctic logo. So what I've done is I've actually measured out and figured out that in between this T and the I is kind of my center positioning. I'm going to go ahead and move my laser head over and using my red dot, just kind of ensure that I'm staying within that area there. I would bring that up to my top left. Down just a little bit here. Again, if you're having trouble with getting your laser to go exactly where you're needing it to do using the arrow keys, you can press the speed button on the control panel and slow that down a little bit. Again, that also helps with the framing speed as well, especially with the rotary tool. It makes it a lot smoother of a test speed and look to it, and you can really kind of follow where it's going to be at. I'm going to nudge it over just about there, and I'm going to go ahead and hit my origin button and then go ahead and frame out. And we look good. We're not going super big today. So we'll go ahead and close our lid and go ahead and hit start. Now it's just going to take a few minutes for that to run, but in the meantime, we'll go ahead and jump back over to our computer and answer any questions you may have. Feel free to type in any questions that you have in the chat dialog box there, and I'll be more than happy to answer them while this is running. Again, just in case anybody is just now joining us, kind of missed the beginning part here. Where I got this image from was actually a book called Dover Publications, available online on Amazon. They have a variety of different types of things. You can get real specific. They have holiday things, so Christmas, Thanksgiving, Halloween. It has a lot of different other types too, as far as like Celtic art. And again, just a really great, easy to use file, place where you can get files from. So I've got Michelle asking, how did I do the math for the art? And did I have to do any kind of special equations? No, I did not need to do any kind of special equations on this one here. I simply needed to match up my circle pulse along with my roller diameter to match with the rotary tool that I'm using. And then it was just simply of just measuring out where I wanted my image to fall at. Richard asking, what do I use to clean the tumbler? I typically just use a little bit of denatured alcohol and a paper towel. Just kind of put it on there and wipe it off, rub it down. Just again, make sure you get any of those oils or greases that may be on that tumbler. Now, Surmark is a great product, again, very easy to clean off. A little bit of water and a paper towel. I'm just going to go ahead and use a little bit of Windex here. Some of my paper towels. There. Kind of see it. Like I said, just something very simple, very easy to do. And I do see that we have a couple other questions on here. And I've got Craig asking, and he's new to laser engraving, and welcome, asking the purpose of the Surmark. Craig, with the CO2 lasers on bare metal, they do like to reflect off of that. So the Surmark is what's creating a bond between the paint and the metal. So as soon as the laser hits it, it's going to permanently bond that material to the metal. And the rest of it, the excess is just going to wipe right off. It's not going to stain your clothes or anything like that either. I have Lisa. Can you get different colors of the spray, or does it all engrave black? I believe Surmark does have a few different types of Surmark. The black is by far the easiest to use. Some of the other types that they sell are, you have to mix up yourself, and the chemicals or the solution they want you to mix it with can be everything from ethanol, can be denatured alcohol, and then it's a self-application as well, whether it's painting it on. I just find it, again, with the LMM 6000, just a very quick, simple, straightforward process there. And we'll go ahead and leave this open a little bit longer. Today was quite a quick video. Like I said, I just kind of wanted to show you the applications. I know we've gotten a lot of questions over Lightburn and how to do certain things in there. Again, Lightburn is a great program, very easy to learn, does a great job with vector art. We will be doing more videos over Lightburn as well. But again, you can see how quick and easy it was just to bring in an image, trace it, and send it right to the machine all in one program. I've got Richard asking, what focus lens length am I using? I'm actually using the 2-inch lens, so I've got a 2-inch focal distance there. The 2-inch lens is kind of like our universal lens. It works very well for a variety of different things, from cutting to engraving on different types of material. When I get to a little bit more finer detail work, I do like switching out my lens. Even running portraits, I typically like to run that like an 1.5-inch lens. If you haven't already, I do believe we have some of our larger lens kits available for purchase. If you don't find it on our store, please give us a call at 844-364-8211, and any one of my service technicians will be more than happy to help you out with that as well. Oh, Michelle was asking, what settings was I using? For my rotary tool, I was using a 10 speed and a 50 power. And that is a great point to bring up too, especially with Stir Mark II, you don't want to hit it with too much power. Especially on flat metal, what can happen is that metal can actually start, from the heat, start bowing up and warping. Also, you can get a overburn with it as well, going too much high power and almost get like a shadow line or an actual line alongside like your text or your image. I have Craig asking, how often do I use the 2-inch lens versus the 3 or the 4-inch lens? My 2-inch is pretty much my go-to lens. The 3-inch I do prefer to use when I'm doing glass work or I'm doing brick work. And then my 4-inch lens is typically only for large curved surfaces, so things like the side of a whiskey barrel, for example, or a casket. We do have plans on getting some of those materials in here as well to kind of showcase those other aspects and the different lenses. And again, if you've seen some of our other previous videos, you have any questions about any of those processes there, we always have technicians standing by that are more than happy to help you out. Our AP Laser University is also filled with a lot of great information under our download sections, where you can find out different things as far as adjusting for tapered cups, speed and power settings, things like that. Okay. Well, if we don't have any more questions for right now, we're going to go ahead and wrap it up. Again, I do appreciate you guys all joining us today. I hope you found this informative. Until next time, you guys have a great day. Bye.